The importance of getting new eyes, for example, by using a whole system perspective, that's essential. And I think the problems of money supply that we've been talking about here can only be solved from that higher perspective. If we focus only on money, we're not really going to be able to solve it, because money is a servant to the economy, which is a servant of society, which ultimately has to reside within nature. So a whole system approach is needed, not just to resolve money, but all of the different problems that we face. And if we use that approach, we'll find out that we resolve many of the major problems simultaneously. So I'll just talk a little bit about, summarize some details of a whole system approach, and then go into one very specific solution, a powerful way to drive monetary and other types of reform by using investing, getting the capital markets to drive system change. But before I do that, I just wanted to touch on 2 points. Gary and Catan were talking about the increased availability of money and how that represents an evolution or an improvement. And in some ways it does, but in some other ways it doesn't. As we've said, while there might be more money available, there's still lots of hungry people and people who are suffering in the world. So that increased money isn't meeting the needs, because, again, as we've said, the goal of the money supply is to make more money, not to meet basic needs. So that's a major transition that has to happen. And also in terms of the history of humanity, if we look at the larger history and the history of life over this planet, 99.99999% of that time, resources were distributed equitably. It's only since the agricultural revolution, when we kind of entered more of a separation consciousness, that we've had rising inequality, and that's continuing to this day. I mean, we used to, early religions saw nature, humans saw themselves as part of nature, so we operated in harmony with nature. There were problems. But at the agricultural revolution, we started to push nature aside, violating our old religions, so we came up with new religions that made it okay, that put humans above nature and said we were separate from each other. And this separation of thinking is kind of the genesis of our economic and political systems, which continue to put us in conflict with each other and nature, and are the root cause of all of our all the major environmental, social, and economic problems addressed by the SDGs. So, we talked also about how things are starting to change, the reinsurance companies and others are pressing companies on climate change. That's because reality is the great teacher. They're being taught, you know, we're going to lose money if we don't do a better job with climate change. But it's happening too slowly. We already know, not just climate change, we know what the environmental and social problems are. We're kind of waiting for insurance companies or others to take care of it, when we, the people, through government, could demand action on those right now. And we don't have a lot of time. We can't wait till these problems become clear to everyone. If we do, it'll probably be too late. So we need to kind of push the change down, and that can only happen through systems, because the systems are what are controlling corporate behavior. We can't go to companies and say, voluntarily stop doing what you're designed to do. That's the same as telling them to die. Instead, we have to change the system that's causing them to do the harmful behavior. So just to, one way to do that is through a whole system approach. And one way to frame that up is to start out by putting the what before the how. Meaning, before we get into the details of how to change, which are mind-numbingly complex, we put up on the wall what it is that we want. And by focusing on reality, the reality is there are laws of nature that we must abide by, and these can be guidelines for human economic and political systems. They're not philosophies or values. These are absolute requirements for life and prosperity on this planet. And some of those laws include equitable resource distribution, equally valuing current and future generations, seeking balance, not growth, cooperation, living on renewable resources, producing no waste, decentralizing governance and production, and enabling individuals to reach their fullest potential. And the implied non-physical laws of nature include equality, fairness, self-government, freedom of expression. Again, these aren't philosophies. These are the observed requirements for life on this planet. the only way we can survive is to align our systems with those. So a whole system approach would look at what are the necessary systemic changes needed to get our systems from here to alignment with that. Some principles are emulate nature. Another one is democracy. We the people have to control our destiny equally and fairly. Another one is the rule of law. If you took all the system flaws that force companies to create environmental and social problems and roll them up into one overarching flaw, it would be the failure to hold companies fully responsible for negative impacts. That makes it impossible in competitive markets for companies to act in a fully responsible manner. If they do, they go out of business. So our systems unintentionally create a system where you must degrade life support systems, you must harm customers and employees. If you don't do that, you can't exist. Nobody intended that, but those are the systems that our companies are forced to operate under. They're going to change either on their own or we'll figure out how to change them before. So to bring about these changes, a whole system approach looks at the actions that are needed in all areas of society. We need actions in government, in the general public, and in the corporate financial sector. Governments that are controlled by vested interests like the U.S. government are unlikely to change on their own. The general public is the most powerful force, but that's a longer term strategy to get them to work together on their common interests, where we need things like weakening political parties, requiring honest media, and having more empowering freedom-based education. Right now, we indoctrinate our children by making them sit in sterile rooms for 35 hours a week listening to adults talk to them. We rank them against each other, which is unnecessary. It makes them feel inadequate. We force them to study things that they're not interested in. They're constantly monitored by authorities. That creates a cowering, compliant population that can be easily manipulated by vested interests. We're teaching our young people to endure control by authorities and boring jobs for the rest of their lives. So why are we ranking children against each other? We don't need to do that. So we can, through freedom-based education, we can empower young people. And then the most important short-term action, I would say, is to use investing to drive system change through an approach that I would call system change investing. Because when the people are divided and conquered, the corporate and financial sectors are the most, in most countries, the most powerful force in society. Those sectors are controlled by investing. We've been very successfully using investing to get companies to do sustainability for 20 years. We can use that same mechanism to get them to do system change. And the approach simply involves rating companies on system change performance, making a strong business case why investors will make more money if they invest in system change leaders, developing funds based on those ratings. And then once investors put money into system change funds, companies will be incentivized to work for systemic changes, just like they're incentivized now to work for sustainability. So that it's a $30 trillion market, and all it requires is a simple change in a new type of ESG rating, where you make the same types of funds delivered through the same types of channels. It's simple, and you know, so that's why I'd say it's the most powerful short-term mechanism for driving change. And within the series of type changes there, we could get companies to engage in changing the monetary system and all the other systemic problems we have, like limited liability, time value of money, all the things that force companies to cause harm. However, in terms of marketing it, I wouldn't suggest that we go straight out to companies and say, we're going to get rid of interest and get in limited liability and time value of money's gone too. They wouldn't sign up, they'll run away. So instead, we go out to the companies and say, here's why these systems are creating growing problems for you, investors, and society overall. And they're going to change one way or the other. You're much better off taking a seat at the system change table and helping to manage the process in a way that protects you and your investors and society overall and gives you lots of benefits along the way, enhancing your reputation, making it easier for you to attract and retain a high-quality workforce, and many other benefits. So that's, I think, we can't evolve the monetary system in isolation. It's got to be part of a larger, I would say, economic, political, even social transformation, because money serves the economy, which serves society. So we've got to look at the bigger picture if we want to come up with an effective monetary policy strategy.